welcome everyone to a special Halloween edition of Night Commerce Bigfoot Radio.
Hello, everyone. Happy Halloween and welcome to Night Callers Bigfoot Radio for our special Halloween edition tonight. Ooh. Anyway, I don't know who all is here. It's kind of like we did the long intro just so that everybody could slide in. It's a busy night. It's Halloween. We've got trick-or-treaters. We've got people that are doing their Halloween stuff and people that are stuck at work. And so it's going to be very interesting. But I think that I know for a fact that I'm here, Laurie Hood, and Lauren and Ricky Smith are here. Are you here, Jeff? Let me see if this is Jeff.
You have to unmute him. I'm just saying. It helped.
Okay. Hey, Jeff, are you here?
Hello.
No. Okay. All right.
Sure
I have everybody unmuted. Okay. All right. Well, I know that three of our guests are here, and thank you very much for coming. And we're going to get to you in just a second. In fact, we can't wait to start interviewing you. I don't know where Jeff is. I guess he got hauled off by a ghost. Who knows? But he will be here soon, I'm sure. Okay. But anyway, tonight we want to encourage everyone out there that if you have a ghost story or a ghost experience, paranormal experience, to share and would like to share it, you can call in at 347-989-0313 and press 1. If you don't press 1, we won't know you have something to say. We'll think you're just listening in. So be sure to call in at 347-989-0313 and press 1, and we'll bring that number up several times during the show tonight. So, Lauren, how are you and Ricky doing tonight? Y'all been trick-or-treating already, right?
Yes, we're doing good. We went around the block, and we hustled because we knew we had to do the show, but we got a gigantic bag and a bucket full of candy. My kids went as Calvin and Hobbes. My four-year-old was Calvin, and the baby was the tiger Hobbes. And only, like, 3 people got the reference, which is kind of sad, but that's okay. They were still cute, and the four-year-old had a great time. He tried to bust in a few houses. It was luckily the people laughed, but it was pretty scary. He would just open the door and walk in.
He tried to go into their house?
Yeah, he would open the door and walk in. Like, and not open the door. He would bust through like the Kool-Aid man, like trying to walk up in their house to get the candy. Oh, my gosh.
Oh, gosh. Well, he knows how. I don't know. He's already becoming a little burglar.
That's what I said. I was like, he's practicing his breaking and entering. Emphasis on the breaking. It was ridiculous. Anyway, so yeah, it was fun. We got to give a little bit of candy out to our trick-or-treaters. Ricky put his werewolf mask on and scared a whole bunch of little girls. He's so bad.
Now pick on somebody his own size.
Right.
God.
Anyway,
oh,
but yeah. So, how's your Halloween?
And so what are you doing right now? You're doing live video.
No, I will be. That's when true. I go to tell my story, I'm going to do the live video.
Okay.
Yeah, I figure me just talking randomly without the other side would be pretty boring. So.
Right.
So when I tell my own paranormal story, I'll be doing it live, which is really scary.
Okay.
So that's my scare for the night, I guess. I get to scare everybody with my face.
Okay, because I've never done the live thing on Facebook, so that's pretty interesting.
But we'll make it work.
You're terrified. Are you in costume?
I have face makeup on, so technically, yes.
Oh, okay. All right.
So.
All right. Okay.
You want to listen?
I'm not quite sure what to do here. We've got, I want to make sure that we have all of our guests here first before we get started. All three of them are 903 area code. So the 754, is that you, Eddie?
No, that would be me and Jeremy.
Yeah.
Okay, that's Jeremy. Okay, let me put that
in
there.
And Debra.
Oh, Debra.
They decided a tag team call in, so.
Okay, and then Debra, are you the 539?
No, Jeremy and I are together on that 754 number. We're here at my house.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, and the other two numbers, me and Carla.
Okay. And so, the 539 is.
me and Carla both have 539 numbers, which is Eddie and Carla.
Okay. I don't know. I can't figure out who is who. So we'll just go with that then. Okay. All right, we have a 409 number, and they've got a 1 there. Let me see if they have a story, and let me just check on this. Okay. Hello, 409 area code. You're on Night Caller.
Hello, Lori.
Radio. Do you have a story to share? Hi. Who is it?
Lori, this is Texas 7mm.
Oh wow! Hi.
What? Oh my gosh.
Long time no hear.
What
bud.
A blast from the past.
That's awesome.
Wow.
Thank you for joining
wonderful
us.
Wonderful to hear from you. Yes.
I finally got my dumb phone to work, okay?
Oh, okay.
Oh, well, that's a good thing. Hey, do you have a scary story to tell us?
Yes, I do. Remember when
okay.
my grandfather
well, how about
died
you-
in... When my grandfather died in 2000, and my dad was at the hospital, they called me. It's 1 o'clock in the morning. They told me he'd passed. It was more relief than anything else. And I laid my head back down on the bed, went back to sleep, but then I was out at the deer lease around the fire. I was alone, but I wasn't alone. More real than any dream ever.
Wow.
And I looked across the fire from in there, sat my cousin Benny, who'd been dead for 2 years, just like I remember him, sitting there. And I looked to my left, and there is Doc Edson, who'd been dead 5 years, just like I remember him. Then I looked down the hill, and here comes my grandfather, up the hill. And, you know, he's walking like a 40-year-old man, not an 80-year-old man.
Huh.
He gets back up to the fire, and I hear something to my right, and I look to my right, and there stands Red Richards. He'd been dead for 15 years. Granted, you know, I'm seeing all of this. I look back at my grandfather. Poof. I wake back up, call up to the ICU unit, and I told my stepmother, so I need to speak to my father. He went to sleep at the foot of my grandfather's bed. I said, Dad,
yeah.
You don't believe this. He said, try me. I said, okay. I said, I was just dearly. He said, yeah. I said, I looked. He said, Doc Edson said, about time you show up. He said, yeah. And he finished the sentence. We wrote down the descriptions and everything. He saw the exact same thing I did, heard the exact same thing
okay.
I did, described everything to a T. Now, that's paranormal for you.
Yeah.
Yes, it is. Sure is. That's wonderful. That's a wonderful experience.
Thank you for letting us hear that.
I know there's room around the fire for me.
Yes,
there is. There you go. You can carry that with you for a long time.
Hey, the funny part is, 2 years later, I'm riding to a graveside. I'm a funeral director by trade. So I'm riding to a graveside service, got a minister there I'd never met before, and something tells me, said, you will share this with him. So I went to tell him the story, and I get through with it, and he starts crying, I'm like, oh, God, I've lost my job, you know. He said, you had no way of knowing this. He said, but I've always wondered if Red made it. I said, huh? He said, Red was my brother-in-law.
Mm.
And he had a deathbed profession of faith, and he'd always wondered if Red had made it to heaven.
Oh, wow.
Praise the Lord. That is a beautiful, beautiful story. Beautiful.
Yep. All right. Well, I'm going to shut up so y'all can go on with the scary stories tonight.
Thank you.
Have a good one.
Okay. Well, thank you so much for starting out tonight. Just wonderful.
Thank you. And
I'm going to sit back and listen, okay? And afterwards, Lori,
you
too, because I've got a humdinger for you.
Ooh.
Okay.
Definitely.
You talking about on the show?
Not paranormal, but the big furry kind, if you know what I mean.
Sweet.
Oh.
All right, y'all take care.
All right, thank you. Happy Halloween.
All right, bye.
Happy Halloween. All right, bye-bye. Okay, now I think we're ready to bring our guests on. So, right. Ms. Lauren, if you will, read that intro. And
can do.
Wow, that was a beautiful story, wasn't it?
That was.
I love those.
A good way to start out, you know, just real positive. Okay. Nightfall. Good Lord. It's been a long time already. I'm not going to lie. I'm exhausted. Okay.
Amen. I will agree with
Radio
you.
Radio presents Star Paranormal Investigations. Star Paranormal is a paranormal investigation team founded in 2014 based in the East Texas area. The team is a good balance of paranormal investigators, including sensitives and empath, technology specialists, and open-minded skeptics. Those always balance it out very well. Members of this team have studied a wide range of paranormal interests from demonology to paranormal photography. Star has investigated private residences as well as businesses in abandoned locations all over Texas, parts of Louisiana, and Colorado. They have spoken at events and led investigations for Tyler Rose City Comi-con, Tyler Paranormal Conference. Together, they are trying to assist people who have nowhere else to turn and are unsure or afraid of what is unexplainable. Star team members are Mike and Debra Sharbeno from Carthage, Texas, Jeremy Nagle, also from Carthage, Texas, Eddie and Carla Hernández, Tyler, Texas, Melissa LeCount, Carthage, Texas, and I will be posting a link into the chat of them recording one of their sessions. So join us this Halloween night as we share our own ghostly experiences, talk with professional paranormal investigators, and share real EVPs. If you have a ghost story to share, you can call in at 347-989-0313 and make sure to press 1 so that we know you have a story to tell.
Great. Thanks a lot, Lauren, for that. Hey, Star Paranormal. Apparently, Mike is not here tonight. He's the one that got stuck at work. But we have the rest of the team here. So I guess I'm going to start out with Eddie. Eddie?
Yes, ma'am.
I'll speak to you first. Okay. And so you're here with your – tell us who is with us tonight. Go ahead and introduce your team, if you will.
Well, I'm here, of course, and I'm actually a skeptic, and I'm kind of the technology guy, so I'm in charge of kind of making sure that everything is working good as far as equipment-wise. My wife is also on the line. Her name is Carla. She is a sensitive, and she's on the line as well, as I said. Mike didn't make it. He's kind of the leader. He's the one that goes through a lot of the evidence. He's hyper-focuses a lot on the evidence whenever the time comes. Jeremy is on the line as well, along with Debra, which is Mike's wife.
Okay.
Debra's also a skeptic. She's a little bit unsure of everything. Jeremy is, I believe he's sensitive, and he's also just a crew member. Melissa didn't call in. He didn't make it today, but I guess we'll try to get a hold of her another time. So that's pretty much the group for now. Yeah.
Okay, so basically the majority of you are skeptics.
Well,
so
my question is, skeptic.
Okay. Do you believe in ghosts?
Which one of us are you asking?
Yeah. We have two
Everyone
skeptics.
Wants to
we
answer.
We have two skeptics in our group.
Yeah. Okay,
but
two skeptics. Okay.
All,
yeah.
Well, I'm one of the skeptics.
Paranormal.
Mm-hmm.
I'm one of the skeptics. My thing is, I am a common sense kind of guy. I believe that everything can be explained. The problem being in this field is I'll run into all kinds of crazy things that I can't explain. And that kind of turns me into a believer. But then, you know, once you're away from a situation in your mind, you can start coming up with all kinds of explanations that try to talk yourself out of what you saw. But there's all kinds of things that can't be explained. And that's a big part of this whole thing is finding things and explaining what it is to prove whether it's paranormal or not. And that's my basic philosophy on that. And I think Debra is also a skeptic, but she might have a little bit different belief than I do.
Hey, Debra, tell us what you think.
It's kind of hard for me to explain.
Okay.
When I'm there and I know that we're the only ones in the building or in a location, and I know exactly who all's there, and we get an EVP back, let's say a child voice or another person we know that wasn't there, then, you know, I believe that. What I have trouble wrapping my mind around is a lot of stuff you see on TV. I think a lot of it's sensationalized, maybe scripted to some point. You know, that's what I have. I'm not going to believe everything I watch on TV, you know, and I know there's been several times we've been at different locations that we've debunked most of our evidence that we've gathered for that night, you know, so it's just kind of hit and miss for me. I do believe that there's an afterlife. I do believe that there's spirits here, you know. Do I believe in child spirits? Me personally, no.
Even though one of the EVPs that you guys sent in was obviously it seemed to be of a child.
Right.
So
and I,
what do you think that was, if it was not a child?
I think that was something posing as a child to try to draw us in closer to whatever that was there. You know, I mean, what's going to scare you the most? Something that might be kind of mean-spirited? Are you going to be drawn to it sooner, or perhaps a child? You know, you're going to be more trusting of that child. So that's just my way of thinking.
Well, I'm very interested in how each one of you got involved in paranormal investigations. How did it start for you guys?
For Mike and I, a friend of mine worked in a local business here in Carthage, and it used to be an old funeral home, and they had a lot of activity going on in the building, and she knew Mike watched all the TV shows and stuff and was interested in that sort of thing. She invited us up that night, and we kind of crashed another team that was doing an investigation there at her place of work. And for us, it just kind of took off from there. I started going along with my husband, just because we do most everything else together. So, and then Jeremy's my cousin, and he started going on hunts and investigations with us. And from there, we met Eddie and Carla, but I think, Do you have stuff going on with you as a child, maybe? Here, you can talk.
Oh, here I am. My name's Jeremy.
Hi, Jeremy.
How are y'all tonight?
Fine. How are you?
Oh, I'm well. Couldn't be any better.
Good.
Anyway, yeah, what Debra was saying, when I was a child, I had several different experiences with me. Probably one of the ones I talk about the most. I remember living in an old house and waking up. I was very young. I was 4 or 5 years old, and I remember waking up and something, I didn't feel well or something to that effect, and I was trying to go wake up my parents, and when I walked into their bedroom, I saw two now what we would describe as apparitions, one on either side of my parents' bed. And it terrified me, and I went running back to my bedroom. I threw the covers over my head and was terrified. Of course, the next morning I got up and I told my parents what had happened, and I got told the bad dream and all this other stuff.
It's your imagination.
And, oh, yeah. Absolutely. You know, there's no such thing.
Story of my life.
And all the...
Yeah.
So it actually, funny enough, you know, being told that enough as a kid, that's kind of what I chalked it up to, and I never really talked about it again. We fast forward a few years to my teenage years, and I had a friend and a person that friend was friends with actually lived in that same house. And never told the story to him before, and we ended up hanging out at that house. And, of course, I was uptight. I was uncomfortable there, and they finally asked me what was wrong. And I just told him, you know, I used to live in this house. There's just some weird things that happened. And the guy proceeded to tell me, he was a little bit older than us, he proceeded to tell me, yeah, my wife won't sleep in the master bedroom. He says every time she wakes up in the middle of the night, she says the room is freezing cold, and she usually sees two elderly people standing on either side of her bed. And, yeah, so I've kind of always been, and like I said, I've had several more experiences, but that, to have that one confirmed for me was the icing on the cake. And I've done stuff with my mom and my sister. We went and tried to investigate the Myrtle plantation in Louisiana, but we had
wanted to go there.
Well, we had fun, but we didn't see anything. But a lot of that was because we had no idea what we were doing. And now that I know, I would love to go back there and do something different, but it wasn't until, like Debra said, when she talked about crashing the investigation, which was the first one they officially did. Funny story was, Debra kind of told me and my sister about it, and I'm like, well, we want to crash it too. So we actually showed up to the same investigation and just kind of became part of it, and we've been doing it ever since. There for a little while, we were actually team members with that. We joined that group. They were called the Paranormal Junkies, uh-huh. And they're still around. We kind of just wanted to form our own group due to different ideologies and things like that, and we consider the Paranormal Junkies good friends and family of ours. So, but just different ideologies, and so we just split and decided to start Star Paranormal, and we've been doing that and having a blast ever since.
Gosh, that sounds wonderful. You know, Jeremy, your childhood sounds similar to mine. When I was young, I had several, quite a few paranormal experiences. My father was military, so we moved all the time. And it seemed like no matter where we lived, there was something there. If there wasn't, but a few places that we ever lived that I didn't see something or experience something there, it was just, and of course, you know, my parents said, no more scary movies for you. You were just imagining it. You know, I remember one time going and getting my mother because there was a strange man sitting in our living room. And I could see him plain as day. He was not see-through or anything. He was a person sitting there, but she couldn't see him. She could not see him. And I knew then, and I was probably about 7 years old by that time. I remember it was about the time Kennedy was killed. So I was about 7 years old. And so I knew then that, well, I didn't really understand the concept of what ghosts were at that particular time, but I knew then that I thought that there was something really wrong with me. I would see things that other people didn't see. I really didn't have anybody to tell me that it was okay to see those things. So
But this went on all the way through my adolescence up into my early 20s. And then after that, it was it reverted to seeing it through my peripheral. I could only see them through my peripheral, and now I just get a sense they're around, but I don't see them anymore. I guess I finally grew up like Peter Pan. I'm no longer a kid. I don't know. Well, I just don't see them anymore.
Right. And I sometimes, you know, they talk about sensitivity. Eddie mentioned a little bit, I guess. I think when I was
you
little,
must
I
be.
Was, but having my parents tell me, you know, it was nothing, you didn't see anything. I think I shut a lot of it down until I just became a little older. But, you know, if you want the funny way of how we got started in paranormal investigating, I was about 3 years old when Ghostbusters came out, and my dad took us all to the theater to watch Ghostbusters. So,
and how old were you, three?
I was three. I believe Ghostbusters came out in 86 or 87, somewhere around there.
Wow.
And it's still what I, from the day it came out until now, I still sit down and watch it, so I blame my dad for a lot of it.
Well, have all of you been on an investigation together, like in one place? Or do you guys split up the teams? Okay. Can you share with us a pretty good area that you went into and some interesting things that happened? And we do have some EVPs that we'd be glad to share and just kind of guide us through this. And we'll play the EVPs as you ask for them. And do you know which ones we have? Does anyone know? Because Mike was kind of
in charge. Mike. Although he is not our leader. Just let me set that straight for everyone.
He's not the leader.
Well, you know, when you're married, you can never be the leader.
I know you have the child-sounding voice from Terror Knot, and I know you have one that speaks about Afghanistan. I'm not sure what else he sent you.
Okay, he sent Business is Haunted.
If
he doesn't like the floor.
And then we can kind of give you a backstory on any of them if you want it.
Okay, that's awesome. Let's do Business is Haunted first.
Okay.
You want me to go ahead and play it? Okay.
You think you can do that? Move closer to it for us, but lights it up. So let me try it. There you go. We've seen a little flash.
It's it.
Okay, let me play it again.
Okay.
You think you can do that? Move closer to it for us, but lights it up. So let me try it. There you go. We've seen a little flash.
Okay, where is it saying it? Is it? Okay, I'm not.
I think it's
hearing Business is Haunted.
That one, I think it's more
Karate.
Towards the middle of it. I think it's right as she's saying, there you go, flash the lights, and that kind of in that area. One of the
okay,
devices
is it the,
that we
is
use.
Is it a male voice?
I believe it's a male voice.
That
yes,
was,
right.
That was
okay.
Coming across the spirit box.
Right. One of the devices we use is called the spirit box. And I believe that's what was being used when we captured that. The spirit box kind of runs through, scrambles, you know, when you put your car radio on scan and it tries to pick up the best radio station. That's kind of what the spirit box does in a sense, only it doesn't stop at its strongest source. It just cycles through radio stations constantly, and you get a lot of background and static noise. I don't know how many people have heard the theory of white noise or, you know, white when you're TV has a bunch of static on it or through a radio, you're supposedly, it's a little easier to pick up the theory of spiritual voices, and that was one of the devices used. And that's one you have to really, yeah, you have to really know how to listen to that and where you're listening at and things like that. And make some of those EVPs that we've captured, it's technically not an EVP because you can actually hear it with your own ears.
Right.
But a lot of our equipment, a lot of things I think Mike sent you is based off of that spirit box, and there's another one that's more up-to-date called an echo box, which kind of does the same thing, only more...
You can explain what I was saying about moving closer to that light.
Right. But the echo box kind of does the same thing, but it takes the static out of it. It's a little easier to understand that echo box. But like I said,
uh-huh.
That particular clip was done on a spirit box, and Debra is using in that, she's using a device called the K2 meter, which is a EMF detector, electromagnetic field detector, that we use when we investigate. And at that time, what we were experiencing, the theory is, as you're using that, when a spirit moves closer to it, it'll actually put off its own electromagnetic field, causing the lights to light up. And it starts at green, and it can, depending on how strong it gets, go all the way to red. And at the same time, Debra's going, there you go, make it light up a little more. That's at the same time we get over that spirit box, business is haunted. But you kind of have to turn the volume up a little bit and really listen for it. But I believe it's right in that area where she's talking about the lights on the box.
Okay, I'm gonna play it one more time, and maybe our listeners can hear it. So let's go again.
You think you can do that? Move closer to it for us, but lights it up. Here, let me try it. There you go. We're seeing a little flash.
Wow.
Did you hear it?
Yeah. That's really strange. I would have thought it was somebody there that said it.
Right.
It was that.
And I don't remember what business we were at. It's been a long time since we've done that one.
We were out in the flag shed out behind McClendon House. That stores all the flags.
That's right. That's right. The McClendon House was a... We got permission to investigate there. That's one of those places you have to get permission to go to. And it is an old historical house, one of the first houses in Tyler, Texas. So,
okay.
And they use it as a museum. There's a lot of activity there, a lot of history at that location. So I don't know how many Mike sent you from that. Because he kind of sent us a text message that we're trying to read on the other phone that tells us all the EVPs that we're trying to tell y'all about. So.
Okay.
So. But I don't know. I don't know how many of those that Eddie and Carla know about. I'll let them talk because. If it was up to me, I'll spill it the whole hour just blabbing my mouth off.
Well, and we actually have Lauren is asking me. She said, I thought we were going to tell our stories first and then bring them on. Well, I didn't know we had an order that we were going to do things tonight. So what I want to do is talk with you guys for a while, and then we are going to share our – she's wanting us to share our own personal experiences. So we've had some strange things happen to us. And all three of us, actually. So we'll get to that, too. But I would like to talk with you guys first because you bothered to call in, and we thank you so much for calling in, and you're a guest tonight. So this one, I like the floor. I think that's the one that sounds like the child.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
mm-hmm.
It does.
Let me play this one. It's so clear. It's spooky. Okay, let's.
And this has been off the chart the whole time.
Come over here and get closer to the
thing. Well, down here it's nothing, but up here.
Look at that.
Bye.
Yeah, look at that. That's crazy.
Yeah. Hello, before.
Yeah, you hear that. Child, right at the end. Let me play it again.
Mm-hmm.
And it sounds just like a child.
And this has been off the chart the whole time.
Come over here and get closer to the thing you get.
Well, down here, it's nothing, but
look at that. Bye.
Yeah, look at that. That's crazy.
Yeah. Hello, before.
Where was this at? That was at Terra Nights.
That Terra happened Nights. At an actual
haunted house. Yeah, what is Terra
Nights?
Was it like a haunted? Oh, a haunted house. Okay.
Right.
It's
Terra
a haunted
Nights
house.
It's actually a haunted house attraction. That's actually haunted.
Yeah.
Okay. Which we have a lot of stories from people that work there would tell us things that happened to them, and they didn't know that it was a haunted house when they started working there as haunted house actors. So it makes it a real interesting situation for them.
Huh.
And there is a floor in that
haunted
house that lights up.
Oh, my gosh.
Yeah,
like
there's
where
a piece of floor in there. I think me and Debra talked about that one time, is that's what the child was referring to, was the floor that lights up when you walk across it.
Wow.
And during that investigation, there was no children. We don't usually have children with us anywhere we go.
No, I wouldn't think
it was
would,
nothing but adults.
You know, what?
And you could even hear the voice. It sounds like it was closer to the microphone than everyone else that was talking. It was clear, louder, and just totally different than everybody else's voices.
And that location, and Jeremy may know more about it than I do, but I know, I believe it used to be an old railroad yard or something, and then Tyler Pop took over, and it was before OSHA, and there was people getting hurt and getting killed there. And I believe some homeless people moved in there after that, and I think there was a fire, and they got some of them died in the fire before it became a haunted house. So there's a long history of that property anyway.
Yeah.
And then also as decorations for the haunted house, they brought in a lot of antiques, a lot of old dolls, a lot of old toys. So it's also possible that something came attached to one of those toys and looked around and saw, wow, this is like a playground for me, and just goes around in there.
Is there anyone in your group that can pick up energies on objects? Do they have that? What is that, tachometry or what is that called? Where you can feel an energy on an object. Anybody in your group have that ability to feel that?
Well, I feel like I can feel energy. I can tell if I'm around something, if something bad has happened there, I can feel it.
Okay, who is this, Carla or Debra?
Yeah, this is Carla.
It's Carla.
Okay.
All right. I don't know about me being able to pick up the energy. I'm more of a, I usually can pick up the energy of a spirit there. But through numerous, I can't tell you how many investigations we've actually done at Terra Nights. That's one of our, I think every team has a place that they go that's their hot spot. If you can't go anywhere else, well, let's just go back here and do this one again, because there's always something different happening. And we did learn that and we have to piece this together through several different investigations. We've done that numerous times to come up with different stories. I believe at one time we were actually told by a spirit through the spirit boxes and whatnot and actual EVPs that there are over 50 spirits at Terra Nights. And through piecing together our evidence, we had learned that a set of lockers had been brought in. And one of the spirits, we merely just call him Mr. Lee, but one of the spirits, Mr. Lee, has told us that he was there just because he was attached to the lockers.
but
is there anyone in your group that's like a ghost magnet? It seems like that more things happen when this individual is there.
I would say he's not necessarily a member of our team. We call him a family member. I'm just going to throw him out on the radio there. His name's George. His name is George. His name is George Jones, actually, and not the country singer. But George is kind of the reason ultimately the Star Paranormal became the way it is because of George. And the locations mm-hmm. we've been able to investigate, 90% of them are because George has gotten us in there. Or George has called us saying, hey, I need y'all to come investigate this place for me. But that being said, George is the one who's at these locations way more than we are. And
right.
we have
so they're
noticed
familiar
a lot
with him.
They're very familiar with him. He gets mad at us when we make fun of him for this. He's a bit of a scaredy cat and has a tendency to run.
he's going to love you for saying that on the air.
Oh, I know. I've got stories that I'm not allowed to tell. but I think the spirits being familiar with him, he's there all the time. Plus, they see how he acts when they do start doing things. Usually when we're with him, especially at a place that he's known at, things really kick off when George is there. And there's been some things at Terror Nights that we've managed to debunk. You'll never see a depressed investigator as you were today. We did an overnight hunt. We caught on camera what looked like curtains just moving, like something was moving. Moving in the same direction, like something was moving through the curtains, and Mike and I were practically giddy when we saw that evidence. We're like, look what we got. And I think it was about 2 weeks later we were able to, Debra started the burst of the bubble, and it was about 2 weeks later when we were finally to get back there, and we realized that the curtains were only moving because of the hole in the wall that the wind was coming through. And so, you know, Debra's nickname is Buzzkill. So.
Well, you know, you have to have one. You know, you have to have somebody. We've always had one, you know, when we're Bigfoot researchers, so we have to have the same mm-hmm. thing. We have to have a skeptic, somebody that really keeps our feet on the ground and say, no, that's,
mm-hmm.
let's look into this. Go over there and see what it is. Sure, there's something growling and it stinks to high heaven over there. Let's walk over there and see what's over there. And I go, you go right ahead. You know that means to walk over there. I know what's over there. You go on, you know. But anyway, I guess I'm kind of like George. I can relate
I'm not
to George.
I'm sure it's on George. Everybody who meets him knows this. So.
Well, has any one of you ever been afraid? Have you ever thought yourself? What if? Have you ever been afraid of a ghost or just in a situation where you felt like maybe there was something evil or just?
Well, I'll let
uncomfortable or.
I'll let Eddie and Carla start with that, and we can work our way back.
Okay.
And they're just laughing at me because there's a couple of stories I have, and she's trying to hold herself together right now.
Okay.
So.
I can't think of one that
Eddie
really
and Carla.
Scared. Oh.
Go ahead,
Eddie.
I'm sorry.
I guess me just being who I am, I worry about my wife being there with me.
Mm-hmm.
I'm a little bit overprotective in that, but being in situations where I can feel that something isn't right and I'm not sure what's going on, walking through a room, you might get chills all of a sudden and not know why. And like I said, I'm kind of a skeptic, so it shouldn't hit me like that. But there's been times where I could feel like a dark presence or something. I feel like I have to protect my wife, and that's my main fear, is not being able to protect, because, I mean, if it's a person, I can stand up to a person. But if it's a spirit or something else, that's my fear, is that I can't protect her from that.
My husband is the same way, so I want, you know, that's a normal thing.
Yeah, it's just, I mean, you can't really explain it. Sometimes just being somewhere, all of a sudden you'll feel like a darkness and get chills, chill bumps on your arms, and just not know why.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm not sure if my wife ever has been scared. She's got Chihuahua syndrome. She thinks she's the toughest thing around.
That would be Lori. That would be Lori.
Oh, my God, that is perfect. Okay, Carla, how about you, Miss Chihuahua Syndrome? Have you ever been anywhere where you wished you hadn't been, or you wished you, that, you know?
Not really. I don't think I've ever really been scared. There's been times I felt uneasy. There's been times I've even gotten nauseous, something that I can feel something. Like you said, something heavy is how it'll feel to me if there's something there that I don't want to say demonic. I don't think that I've probably never encountered anything demonic that was just actually really demonic. I've come across evil, what I would consider evil or mean spirits. But I don't think the only time I just can't think of any time, like you said, I'm not really scared of ghosts, I don't think.
I ain't scared of no ghost.
Oh my gosh.
How about you, Debra? Have you ever been anywhere where you wished you were just like, what am I doing here?
Yeah, there was one night, and the group will know the night I'm talking about, that we were all someplace together, and just I felt a pressure and heaviness actually pushing on my chest. And we were leading a tour group, and I didn't want to say anything because, one, you know, we're there with people that don't know us. When we're there with our group, I could say anything to these guys, and they're going to know that I'm not BSing or putting on a show or being fake. You know, but you're there with total strangers that you're leading an investigation for, and I didn't want them to think, oh, who's this crazy woman? And so I asked not. But I mean, really, you know, that they don't know us. I asked my husband, Mike, I said, will you take me back to the hallway and point me in the direction I need to go? And he said, why? What's wrong? I said, I just need to get back to what we call the break room or control room where all of our cameras and TV equipment stuff was set up. And I almost burst into tears. And he knew, you know, something was wrong. And he said, what, you know, what is it? What is it? And I said, I couldn't catch a good breath. It's like I couldn't breathe in deep. And it just kind of had me a little unnerved. Some people that were there with us that night made a statement to Mike, you know, of y'all are going to get out from doing this. Debra's not going to come back. And I've never been back in that particular building where I'll move around by myself. I've always got Mike or Jeremy or even Eddie or Carla. I mean, it was just Carla. But used to, I would run those halls in the dark, taking them equipment or running them water or whatever they needed. And after that night, I never would do that by myself again. Just that that uneasiness, you know. So, and I've seen Mike get scared one time, and he says it wasn't from the spirit. We were at a hospital/old insane asylum in East Texas, and he's walking down the hallway, and we'd already made the comment that night of it was a stormy night, the place is abandoned, you know, there's I don't know how many rooms, three-story building, Jeremy, I believe,
yes.
You know, anyone could have been in that building. Anybody could have been in there. And he goes around a corner, and suddenly you hear a loud, what would sound like a foot stomp. And Mike scooted back around that corner faster than I had ever seen him move before. And, you know, we got a good laugh, and he's looking around, and there was no one there. No one there. There was four of us in the building. So I think, I wouldn't say he got scared that night, but probably startled, you know. Because he had already made the comment of, you know, I don't want to come across a homeless person or somebody a living being.
And Mike
exactly.
Is,
that was...
Mike is tough as boot leather, so to see Mike jump, we definitely...
We cracked up laughing.
We still pick on him and make fun of him about it, so...
Which I have a knife that I pick on Jeremy about, that we're out in the dark and he sees what he thinks is Mike or someone standing there, and he turns on the flashlight and there's no one there, and I swear he screamed like a girl and shoved me in front of him, and I'm like, dude, you know what? So I think we've probably all been startled at some point in time, you know. But I'm probably the only one that's actually been scared as far as that night when, you know, I felt that pressure and just didn't, like, I could breathe really good. Eddie and Carla was there with us that night. And it was hard for me to even tell anybody, even the people in our group, you know, for a while, exactly what all happened and everything. Because mm-hmm. I was trying to wrap my mind around it, you know, well, could it have been this? Could it have been that? And I think that partially comes from me more skeptical than Mike and Jeremy, maybe. I questioned a lot of stuff for weeks and months, you know, and tried to explain things away without being able to.
Well, I have an EVP from Bob Bucko. It was actually on another radio show. They were doing a radio show live from a location, I do believe, and this EVP, and it's towards the end. He's explaining something about a Bigfoot experience they had, something or another, and EVP comes right in, and it sounds like, get out. I mean, seriously, like Amityville Horror, get out, you know, so... I want to see if y'all hear this, okay? So I'm going to play it. Y'all ready?
Sure. Action with yeah. one out on a pipeline and power line.
Oh. Really?
Yeah, I don't know if Bob wants to tell the story or he wants me to tell the story.
Well, I'll give it a shot. we planned it. It was actually, I think, our first overnight. We only were together for like a year. And Jason's grandfather owns land. There's windmills and a pipeline going through. So we went up, and he went with us. He stayed at the camp, and we spent the day. We went to different areas. His grandfather had, like, a primitive hunting camp. He went down. And I'll let Jason tell that part of the story. So then, you know, we went back and hung out, and Jason and I went out at night, and we walked for, like, an hour, and we came.
Did you hear that?
Yeah, I heard it.
I did hear it.
Yeah. Let me play it one more time. I wish there was a way I could just, like, play the very end of it, but I can't the way these audio clips are set up. So hold on a second here. Let me try it again.
Action with one out on a pipeline and power line.
Oh. Really?
Yeah, I don't know if Bob wants to tell the story or he wants me to tell the story.
Well, I'll give it a shot. We planned it was actually, I think, our first overnight. We only were together for like a year. And Jason's grandfather owns land. There's windmills and a pipeline going through. So we went up, and he went with us. He stayed at the camp, and we spent the day. We went to different areas. His grandfather had like a primitive hunting camp. He went down. And I'll let Jason tell that part of the story. So then, you know, we went back and hung out, and Jason and I went out at night, and we walked for like an hour, and we came.
Yeah.
That's creepy.
That really gives me the heebie-jeebies. I don't know about you guys, but...
No.
That sounded just mean and nasty, and
yeah.
It really didn't want them there.
No, it really didn't. It really didn't. And you know, they never heard it,
right.
and that's something that I wanted to tell y'all about, that you know, being a Bigfoot investigator, one of my biggest things is recording, and I
right.
set up recording equipment every time I go out in the field, I have come back with EVPs, unexplainable. Somebody speaking, saying a few words on my recording that I know is no one that I'm with. And being where we're at, we're out in the middle of nowhere with nobody involved. So, you know, it's definitely, I think we've got somebody else in there, right?
Hello?
Okay. Hello. Are you back with us?
This is Mike. I finally got on here.
Hey there.
Hey, Mike. Hey, Mike.
I am sorry.
That's all right. We're actually fixing to go to intermission. So we'll be back. I'm glad you made it, though.
It has been one long day for me, believe me.
I hear you.
Okay.
Oh. I got to listen to part of y'all a while ago, but that was it.
Okay.
Awesome. Well, we're so glad you're here. We are. When we come back, though, everyone, we're going to, each one of us, Lauren and Ricky, and I don't know where Jeff is tonight. I guess Jeff got carted away by a ghost. I don't know where he went. Uh-huh. But he's not here tonight, and but me and Ricky all have a story to share. So if y'all don't mind us sharing our stories when we come back, and then we're going to talk with Mike, if that will be okay with everyone.
That sounds great.
What? Sounds great.
Okay. Mike, I hate to run off right now with this intermission, but we got to go with this break. We'll be back in just a few minutes, everybody.
All right.
Welcome back. Oh, that was Luke. Luke Gross. Nice. He was so great, and he could really put stuff together. So it was really wonderful to have. He's going to be on our show next week. So Luke Gross will be back on Night Callers again. It's been a long time. Long time.
Yes,
tonight we're interviewing Star Paranormal, their investigation team from the East Texas area, Mike. Charbonneau, that's correct. Mike just joined us. He got caught at work. What a night. Yeah, it's been one of those nights. Mike, welcome. I'm so glad
to be
back with us.
Yeah, I'm just glad to be away from where I was.
I know. Well, you know what? The rest of your team does a fantastic job telling us about a lot of their experiences and explaining some of the equipment they use and such like that. But we've got a EVP here that says it's called Mike Y. Now, you must have been there because you're the only Mike we've got here, so that had to have been directed towards you, would you say?
That it was. And very surprising. We were at the Jefferson Antique Mill, middle of the day, about 4 o'clock in the afternoon. And me, my wife, Debra, and three other women, besides the owner, were the only people inside the building. Debra received a phone call from our son and said something, and I just turned and said no. Well, between that time of her speaking and me, I caught my first EVP.
Well, I'm going to play that first EVP for you. I'm going to turn it up all the way, too. Let's hear it. Wow, it's only 4 seconds. Okay, so the no is at the very end, right?
Ma'am?
Mike Y, is
yes,
at
ma'am.
The very end? Okay,
yes, ma'am. It's the very last note.
I have a hard time making that out. I'm going to try it again. Huh.
The spirit is asking,
Mike, why can't we talk?
Yeah, Mike, why can't we talk?
Mike,
that's what it says.
Why can't we talk?
I can barely hear
Mike. can't be told. Oh, that's creepy. That is so creepy. Okay, I have one for y'all. Now, as I was mentioning earlier that, you know, as a Bigfoot researcher, I do a lot of recordings. Well, I live way out in the country, and I do not have any close neighbors. And so a lot of times, because I have off and on activity at my house, I'll record, like, right off my porch. Well, one particular night in 2010, it was actually November 14th, 2010, I recorded something I couldn't explain because I was here completely by myself. I have, at that first time, not seeing anyone. I was not married or anything. I was here by myself. So the only other male would have been my son, and it's not him. So I'm going to go ahead and play this. And see what y'all think, okay? It is somebody singing. And it's not anybody I know, okay?
That is creepy.
Sounds like he's in a good mood.
Yeah.
Yeah, he was.
He kind of happy.
Yeah, yeah.
Like,
that's what, that's like, the kind I like to come across.
I'm getting,
I'm
going to
go and play it one more time.
A serial killer walking by your window, like, super excited. He found a woman alone in her house. I don't know. That's just creepy.
Well, I've had two different people see a gentleman standing on my porch, like, overalls and just wearing a shirt over the overalls, opened, which it sounds like my late father-in-law, but this voice is not his. So, yeah, and so I don't know, they've seen him standing on my porch when I wasn't home, so I don't know if this is the same individual or not. I'm going to play it one more time, and because it's kind of noisy because it was outside, and I did have to turn it up, so what's real fun? Yeah.
What is it at the end? Don't get wet.
Don't know. Very strange. Michael, we're going to get back to you in just a moment, but I think that Lauren is wanting to share her story. And so if you don't mind, I'd like you guys to hear Lauren's encounter. And so we can get some feedback from you. Is that all right with you guys?
Sure.
Okay.
Absolutely.
Okay. I'm sure that you guys hear all kinds of things, but let's see if you've ever heard anything like this. Go ahead. It's Lauren. It's your turn.
Oh, hold on. Okay. Okay. So, live night callers tonight. I'm going to be telling my stories. I have two. I couldn't decide. I have a lot. So, I narrowed it down to two. These were the two requested by the people that I told them to. So, the first one is I was about 15, maybe. I was laying in bed asleep, and I woke up. I just opened my eyes, and there was brown cloth in front of my face, somebody standing right by my bed, right in front of my face. And I reared my head back because I, you know, there shouldn't be anyone standing in front of my bed. And this, whatever it was wearing like a monk's robe is kind of what it reminded me of. It was like burlap, but dark, you know, really rough cloth. Anyway, I reared my head back, and it jumped up, and so I pulled the covers over my head, of course, and I can see through my quilt. It was like a weave blanket. I could see through it, and I could see the thing flying over my bed back and forth, just whipping angrily across the ceiling. And I watched that thing probably felt like 30 minutes, but it was probably 2-3 minutes, and then it just went away. But it terrified me. That's the first story. And the second story actually had a witness. My mom, Lori, and I were sitting in my bedroom, and I think he was about 18 months, maybe 2 years old. My son was in there with us. We were all just sitting there on the bed, and all of a sudden the door started opening on its own. And, you know, you're thinking air current, right? Well, then it just stops. And then it starts up again. It just opens the rest of the way. And so we look at the door and look at each other, and we're both kind of just sitting there like, did you see that? And my son is staring into the hallway, and he's looking up like he's looking at space. And so I asked him, I said, Adam, you know, who was that? And he said, Papa. Papa, go home now. And Ricky's grandfather, we called him Papa, and he had passed away the week before. And Adam, he was so little, he didn't know anything about Papa. He had met Papa a couple times, but he didn't know that we called him Papa. So anyway, those are my stories, and you can hear Lori's story next, and then Ricky's story, and also you'll hear from Star Paranormal Group. So thank you for listening.
Thanks, Lauren, for sharing that. What do you guys think? Comments or...
Oh, that sounds really interesting. It does seem that grandparents always have a strong connection to their grandchildren, because we had a similar situation actually happen to us as well.
Really? Is this Eddie that's speaking right now?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Okay.
I think my wife can probably tell the story a little bit better than I can. She's less forgetful about that, so. All right, Carla, tell it.
Which story are you talking about, maybe?
Yeah.
Oh, the doorbell. Well, I know there's so many stories. I don't know which one he's wanting me to tell, but yeah, when my dad passed away a year ago, and he was always, I mean, he does not like people to sleep late, and we're living in his house, and the day after he died, because we moved in here before he had passed away, but the day after he died, we were in bed asleep. There was no one here but me and Eddie and my 13-year-old daughter. And the doorbell rang, and our front doorbell has a distinct sound, and then our doorbell that's in our garage has a distinct sound. Well, the doorbell in the garage rang. I said, somebody's here that knows how to get in the garage. I said, it woke us up. The doorbell woke us both up, and we went out there, and nobody was there. The garage was still closed up. So we've always thought my dad was trying to get us out of bed.
Mm-hmm.
But that same morning, my brother's little boy was playing, and his mama said he just looked up and started laughing and holding his hands out like he wanted somebody, like somebody was standing there playing with him, and he was wanting him to pick him up. And his mother said he was trying to get his attention. And the baby would not even look at her. He was, I guess he was about 9 months old then. And the baby was just reaching for something invisible. And that was the morning, that actually was the morning that my dad passed away.
Wow.
That is, wow. So. Those grandparents,
you know,
they just want to make sure their grandkids are okay.
Yeah.
Yeah. I do believe that the spirits, sometimes they'll hang around a little while before they go on. I've always felt that. I've had experiences when family members have passed, and particularly from the grandparents. More so for them than anybody else. But anyway, okay. And what do you think about the thing that was flying over
Lauren's bed. Now that just gives me the creeps.
I've never seen anything like that. When I was younger, I played with the things that I could see.
Oh,
I
wish.
What I call little people that lived in my closet, and I played with them, but I was never scared. I never had a situation like hers. That would have probably been something that would have scared me.
I have never had a friendly anything. Anything in my house, it was either it was there and it let me know it was there and it left me alone and it ignored me, like it was just, you know, there doing its own thing and it could care less about me, or it messed with me and not in a friendly way. Like, I've never had anything that wanted to be my friend. So I envy you there, because maybe I wouldn't see, whereas you guys have no fear of this thing, of these things. I grew up, my mom was a paranormal investigator. She has Chihuahua syndrome as well. She's not scared of a dang thing. And I think I inherited all the common sense that she should have gotten going into these places. Because I am like, and maybe it's because I was raised up with it and I've seen what they can do and they've messed with me my whole life, that I have a healthy respect for them. And I want nothing to do with them. If you're in my house, I don't care if you're benevolent. I don't care if you're here just chilling, watching my kids. I don't care if you're nice. You need to go. You don't need to be here anymore. That's how I am. Whereas my mom's like, oh, no, they're cool. It just stands outside my window and watches me. It can stay there. No, it needs to go. She kills me. I was raised with this. I was raised to give them respect and, you know, just how to deal with them. And so when other people talk about their ghost stories, it just doesn't faze me. I'm like, oh, yeah, you know, we drove to that was my other story I was going to tell. We drove to San Antonio and did the ghost tracks where the kids push you across. I mean, I think I was like 8. And, you know, it was awesome. It was it was real. But I grew up with this, and so I guess I have a very healthy level of respect for these things and want nothing to do with them. And
do you still have spirits, or is that something that kind of went away?
Do what? I'm sorry.
Do you still see the spirits, or is it something that went away?
No. I see them mostly when I'm not asleep, but I wake up and I'll see them and then they'll disappear. And that happens quite often. They'll be right in front of my face or standing at the end of the bed. The last one I saw actually was this one freaked me out. I was laying in bed and I thought I heard my husband come home because he worked nights at the time. But it was midnight and he doesn't get home till 3. And so I opened my eyes because I thought I heard him go in the bathroom, and I look and there's a hand waving out of the bathroom. Like, not waving side to side, like, hey there. It was waving, like, ta-ta now, waving at me. And then I blink, and I'm rubbing my eyes. You got to think, I was in a dead sleep and woke up because I heard something. So I'm looking, trying to rub my eyes, like, what did I just see? And then it goes away. And so 80% of the time, I think I'm hallucinating, but I think back on it, and I'm like, well, you know, maybe I was hallucinating, or maybe something was really waving at me, like, you know, just going to go do my ghost business, go back to sleep. I don't know. I still get kind of freaked out. I really, honestly, if I see something now, I go back to sleep. I'm just like, eh, it's not going to mess with me. But when they do mess with me, I guess they call it sleep paralysis or night terrors. I call BS, because I have been suitably traumatized by those types of things. I've been held down, wide awake, held down, can't move, can't talk, can't scream. And after that, that's when I have stuff like that happens, when I can't go back to sleep. Those terrify me.
I still have those. I still have the sleep paralysis. And I hate that. I hate that.
It is horrible.
I have to wake up, Eddie. I'm like, we're going to have to wake up a little bit. We're not asleep for a while.
I do that. I turn on the light and I sit up and I usually like read the Bible or like say the Lord's Prayer. I watch YouTube. I have gotten on YouTube and watched Disney movies to calm myself down, because I can't go back to sleep. I'm terrified because it, and I don't know if you've noticed, but I've noticed whenever it happens to me, if I'm in a bed with somebody, like I used to, okay, I was like a senior in high school and I would sleep in mom's bed because I'm a wimp like that. But sleeping like in my mom's bed or with my husband now, whenever that happens to me, it's like they are under a deep, deep sleep. They will not wake up no matter what. Like it takes me forcefully moving them to wake them up when that happens. It's weird.
Yeah.
I don't know if you've noticed
that. I haven't
that.
Noticed that.
And I'm generally a light sleeper.
Yeah. I've gone in there, and there was one time, I'll tell you real quick, I don't want to take up the whole show, but I was having a nightmare about a friend of mine, and it was a possession dream, which possession scares the bejeebus out of me. That's like my biggest fear. So I was having that nightmare, and I woke up from the nightmare and had sleep paralysis going on. I something was on me, and I was screaming as loud as I could, and I couldn't get up. Finally, I moved my way to the end of the bed, and it gave up a little, and I pull myself out of the doorway of my bedroom, and I come around, and at the end of the stairs, my mom's dog, Cookie, is sitting there looking at me, like waiting on me, and I get to her, and she takes off up the stairs, and I run up the stairs after her to get to my mom's room. Well, then I wake up again. Turns out I was asleep through all of that, and I was dreaming it. I wake up again, and I'm like, well, I ain't sticking around if that's going to happen. So I bolt out of bed, run around the corner, and Cookie's sitting at the end of the stairs again. And I'm wide awake this time, for real. And so I chase the dog up the stairs and get in bed with my mom, and I cuddle up to her, and I'm shaking like a chihuahua, and she is not waking up. So I cuddle up to her again, you know, because I'm trying not to be a wimp, but I'm terrified at this point. And so finally I rustle around enough to where she wakes up. But that was the scariest thing, because I was awake. I swore I was awake, and then I dreamed it, and then I really woke up, and it happened again. Oh, my gosh.
Yeah,
that kind of
yeah.
stuff happens to me a lot. I wish it didn't. I wish I had friendly little people in my closet like you do. I would take that in a heartbeat.
Well, you know, as I'm listening, you made some good points about still being scared or worried about some of these things. And I think even to an extent, even I am, being scared of some of these things that are going on, being nervous. I mean, I found out the hard way a long time ago that, you know, these things can actually do stuff to you. They can actually hurt you. And then there's crazy people like Star Paranormal who goes out, as my pastor puts it, goes out and screws with this stuff.
you guys do this for fun?
And then there's people like Mike who don't know how to run away from it. And, I live in a house, my house, it's just me and my dogs, and my little brother lives with me. And but I live on a dead-end street behind a funeral home. And, there's lore and theory and stuff like that. So I've got tons of activity constantly going on at my house. And I've kind of just gotten to the point now, you had mentioned that you ignore it. I've gotten to the point now I ignore it until it starts messing with my dogs. And I'm like, hey, leave my puppies alone.
Mm-hmm.
I haven't had the guts yet. I mean, we've done a small thing at my house, very tiny. And then we did a house blessing, or a cleansing rather, which is good temporarily speaking. But like I said, I think I constantly have it's almost like a revolving door for spirits, just because of where my house is located.
Yeah.
So, but it's something that I try to ignore. But at the same time, I don't want to do any kind of investigating even in my house to make anything worse.
Exactly.
Because
That's why I didn't have anything done at my house, because you want to provoke more stuff.
When we did the cleansing at my house, a friend of mine came over who knew how to do that. And the funny part to me was, these things are in your house. It's not like they're stupid. They hear you talking about plans that you're making and things that you're going to do. And right before we decided to cleanse it, we were like, hey, let's do a small thing real quick. Let's see what kind of information we can get. We got some of our toys out, our spirit box and echo box and things like that. And some of the information we were getting was get him out talking about my friend who had specifically come there to cleanse my house. They were calling in my name saying, get out. And at one point, something even grabbed the back of the recliner and jerked the recliner he was sitting in backwards.
Oh, my gosh.
Nope.
So,
oh, my gosh.
I mean, they knew exactly what we were going
thing,
to
though, right?
Oh, yeah. We got rid of it for I slept great for about 6 months.
Oh, yeah.
It came back.
So,
yeah.
Great so.
Yeah. They say those cleansings aren't permanent.
Right.
No.
But and like I said, you know, the lore is sometimes spirits will follow roads, and then when they get to a dead end street, they're just going to go to the first house that they can come to once it hits the dead end, which is my house. So,
oh.
And that, you know, that's all if it's an intelligent haunting, because there's several different varieties of that. You know, it could be just I lost the word. Mike, what's the word I'm looking for?
Asking me for a word.
Not anymore.
Okay.
residual.
Residual
haunting.
That's
or?
The one. That's the one. You would think I was a professional. But you know, residual haunting is just something that. But residual is just kind of like a copy or a recording playing over and over and over and over again. So.
Mm-hmm. Hey, Lauren, how about getting Ricky on here? He's been wanting to tell his story. Y'all got to hear this. This is the craziest thing.
Well, he informed me earlier.
In
he informed me earlier that he wasn't going to tell his story, and I about punched
Why
him.
Why not?
I said, you don't understand how perfect your story is. It is amazing.
Yes.
It's kind of brief, but he's going to go tell it now. Just give a few seconds. But I got him talked into telling it, so he's just like me. We don't mess around with that kind of stuff in our house. We
respect
it.
Just because there's always too much stuff.
Well, it's because we both, well, especially me, he knows how bad it messes with me. And so he just, we just kind of let we let you guys deal with all that, and better you than us. That's how we look at it. Anyway, he's going to come on and tell his story, and it's a good one.
Yeah.
We may have to unmute him for him to actually be able to talk, though.
Oh, you want me to?
No, I got it. Okay, Ricky.
Yeah.
Okay, go ahead.
I'm beeping. I don't know. I was probably maybe 17, 16 years old. We was at my mom's boyfriend's house and just sitting around watching TV. He had one of those, like, old, probably 60s or 70s gas stoves where the flame lit up through the bottom and heated the ceramic. Sitting right next to his TV, couldn't even tell you what we was watching. Well, he kind of had like this little niche, like an OCD kind of, that he wouldn't get out of bed without his socks on. And when he got back into bed, he took his socks off and they stayed right there. Well, I guess that day he skipped over his socks and went straight to the shower or whatever, but his socks stayed right where he got into the bed. And they were just flattened out like a pair of socks laying on the floor, watching TV, dark in the house. And, like, out of my peripheral, I'm looking at the TV, and then peripheral is in his room, and then even further peripheral is the stove. And all of a sudden, like, I see his pair of socks full, like a foot was in the sock, up to the shin, take about 6 steps across the room, and, like, instantly I froze. Like, it was over. Like, I just shut down, couldn't move. Finally, a few seconds go by, and I tell my mom, I'm like, did you just see that? My mom's like, no, what? I said, Mark's socks just walked across the room. And she's like, well, she's like, no, they didn't. I said, I'm not kidding. Those socks walked across the room. So we turn on all the lights, and we get up, and we go into his bedroom, and his socks weren't where he left them. And he's like, I just put them in the laundry. Well, his closet door was probably 8 feet from the side of his bed to the front of the door, and it was about 4 feet deep into his closet. And he had a, a long string, probably 2 foot long, hanging from the light switch, hanging from the ceiling, like an attic light. And we turn on all the lights, walk into his bedroom. The socks ain't where they were supposed to be. And I kept telling him, they moved. Like, they were full socks, had feet in them. They just walked. We look into the closet, and the socks are about a foot from the wall, like side by side, but the tube sock part where it goes up your shin is laid off to either side, and the light switch is dangling. And wow. I was like, hell no, I'm out of here. Put my shoes on and I took off.
And see, I'd have been asking, who's your sweetest socks?
Yeah.
I'd have to ask, who's wearing my socks?
Yeah. No, I didn't want to know. They can have them socks. They can take whatever socks they might need, whatever else might be in the closet that they needed. They can have it.
Oh, come on, man.
Hell no, you can have it too. There ain't none of that I want a piece of.
That is the kind of thing, if that would have happened to me, I mean, I would retire from ghost hunting only because I wouldn't be able to beat that. That would be the topping for me.
I'd be sitting in the closet with a voice recorder. Who is here?
I don't care. My mom, like, she'll try to bring it up sometimes and joke about it. And I'm like, don't joke about it. It ain't nothing to play with. Shit is real. I've seen them socks go across the room.
you should have just informed the spirit that it's not very sanitary to wear dirty socks.
Right?
Yeah. It's like, who wears other people's socks? You don't know where them socks have been.
I'd had to tell him the same thing I told my boys, to keep them out of my sock. I got athlete's foot. You don't want that.
It makes you wonder what goes to do with your underwear when you're not there, right?
I never thought about that until now.
Well, I always find my underwear halfway across the house when I get home from work, and I always assumed it was my dog because he has a fetish and he's just really weird. He's been that way since he was a puppy. I don't even know. Anyway, but now I kind of wonder, after listening to Ricky's story, if I don't have a cross-dressing ghost in my house.
Well, it did wave at you kind of funny, like you're flaming gay, kind of.
Hello.
Did you change his name to Caitlin?
Oh, my gosh. I hope we left that ghost at the other house when we moved. I don't know if I can handle that. I have to hide my makeup from a ghost. That's just not right.
Wow.
Wow.
But that's all I got to say about that.
Yeah.
All right. Well, thank you, Ricky, for coming on and sharing that. You know, everyone's wondering if you were ever going to talk on this show. Well, now he has. He talked about the walking sock.
Well, I only get Rick. I almost need a bullhorn just to get the word in there.
Yeah.
Well, if your wife didn't have you on mute, like the whole last show, she had you on mute. That's why you couldn't say anything.
Well, no. Maybe it's because I get enough of his voice. You know, the rest of it. I'm kidding. I love you.
Yeah.
Don't be mad.
Okay. All right, we're back with our paranormal team. What kind of equipment do you use now? You have the ghost box. I think that's what you said it was, and the echo box. And what else do you use? Investigation.
Well, we use K2. We have our K2 meters.
Nail meter, REM pod.
Okay. Not everybody knows what those are, Mike. I love you, man.
And a thermal
camera.
Yeah. The mail reader meter and K2 meter, it's all very similar stuff. It all picks up, like I was explaining earlier, electromagnetic frequencies. The mail meter, for some reason I can't say that, It picks up on temperatures. It's more of a digital EMF detector, where the K2 meter uses light. The mel meter actually uses numbers on a display screen.
And it also uses an audio tone for a proximity antenna. If something was to get too close to that antenna, after we've already done a check on the room, it lights up and makes all kinds of noises, which it's, I think in the couple of years we've been doing that, this thing has gone off only two or three times, and we've almost died with excitement. So, Eddie is actually more of our technical guy. He's actually built a few things for us that we play with. I mean, the stuff that we take with us is a lot of the stuff we use that you would see on TV, you know, your cameras, your still photos. We try to record some of the stuff. But like I said, Eddie has built some things, so I'll let him talk about some of the stuff he's done.
Well, I've tried a lot of little experiments. A lot of what I'm doing is just trying to figure out something new. Sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't. I had rigged up a camera on a remote control car so I could drive it around, and it's recording audio and video with the headlights were modified to be night vision. So that, you know, you drive that little car around where you're not in the room, and it was shooting night vision infrared light out. And the camera was mounted on top of recording. That kind of worked, except that you could hear the car movement, so I kind of didn't like that too much. I did build a portal, which is Steve Huff. He's one of the big paranormal guys in the paranormal world, and he designed a portal, and I basically went by his specifications and built one as well. We have a couple other little gadgets, temperature gauges, and one that measures movement. It feels vibrations. So if there's any vibrations at all, it'll measure it. So if everyone's standing completely still and all of a sudden it senses movement, you know, where's it coming from? But, yeah, I mean, a lot of the stuff I work with is just basically trying to improve upon what we already have. We're trying to put it in a more portable or better case. It's just a bunch of trial and error. If it works better. If it doesn't work better, move on to the next thing. But there's
have you ever
more and more
investigated anywhere where the temperature dropped dramatically, like 10 degrees?
Yes.
Yes. El Charo. We did a Mexican restaurant in Tyler that had been closed for several years. The owner had passed, and we'd heard several stories about the place, and we were in there in the back room. And for some reason, whoever's spirit is back there in that back room doesn't like Jeremy. But as soon as it found Jeremy, it caused the temperature to drop from 78 to, I think it was 68 or 67.
It was more than 10
degrees.
And it got crazy back there. We use another piece of advice called ovulus. And
what did I say?
Piece of equipment. I'm a little tired. But it's called ovulus. And it's a word database. The spirits can manipulate their energy and form words.
Mm-hmm.
And it was calling Jeremy all kinds of cute names.
Jeremy gets
really?
The spirits.
Really?
Yeah, he does.
Why is that, I wonder?
there is a reason.
I wasn't going to say a whole lot about it, but especially at that Mexican food restaurant we were talking about, they did back when it was first in operation, and there's a lot of history that we probably aren't allowed to go into, but at one point they hired illegal immigrants to work there. And I am in law enforcement, and that was one of the ways we were trying to trigger some kind of reaction is because they had started, I say the spirit started it. They started talking bad to us first. I run in and I show my badge and make sure it was kind of prominent. And, you know, and I started saying, you know, deportation. I started, you know, saying some Spanish terms, deportation. I was with ICE and stuff like that. And
Well, and then it just went lovely from there, so.
So you were provoking them, basically.
Yeah, and normally we don't do that, but, you know, Mike and I have a bad habit. If a spirit picks on somebody in our team or if it starts talking bad to us first, we have a bad habit of not wanting to back down from it. So usually we show a lot more respect and a lot more restraint, but I just don't like – Mike and I have a bad thing about bullies, and we don't like them. So.
Yeah. And these ghosts are probably used to having their way, scaring people off by being aggressive.
Right.
And,
Right. And when you got somebody that won't leave, when you're constantly telling them, get out and leave, and that is probably, I think, if we got one EVP, more than any other EVP, it's something telling us to get out.
Or leave now.
Oh, my gosh. You don't hear it at the time, so you don't know that they've asked you to leave until you go back and review.
Well, a lot of times.
So do you review it before you leave?
We started doing that. In the very beginning, we didn't, and we learned that once we got home and the guy sat down to review the evidence, we were missing a lot of stuff. And then some places we could go back and get back into, some places we couldn't. So now it's kind of typical, maybe what, every 20, 30 minutes we'll stop the voice recorders and rewind. Or if one of us thinks that we've heard something, you know, then we'll stop and rewind and play back right then.
Okay.
Yeah,
well, we have about 11 minutes left, so just talk about whatever you would like to talk about, share with us.
We've started doing something new, that taking our voice recorders and just wearing headphones or earphones and listening live while you're recording. You would be surprised at stuff you can actually hear better through that microphone on your recorder than trying to hear it with just bare ears and recording and then go back and listen to it.
Wonder how a bionic ear would work.
Ooh. That would be cool, but isn't it a directional device? I mean, it'd have to be pointed.
Yes, it is.
Yeah.
The microphone itself is not, but the dish makes. Yeah, the dish makes it directional, but if you just have the microphone, then it would pick up omnidirectional, I mean, all the way around. So.
Right.
But you're getting every possible creak and crackle
walking on grass. And we've done experiments.
Yeah.
Of course, a lot of the things we do is stuff that we've seen. It's like, hey, let's give that a shot. And we've done stuff like put noise-canceling headphones on a member of our group and gave them a voice recorder or plugged the headphones directly into our spirit box. And while they can't hear the questions that we're asking, they're spitting out what they're hearing coming from the device through the earphones right then. And that's probably the spookiest. Mike says fun. It's really spooky. But they have no idea what you're asking. And then, you know, you say, what is your name? And then the person wearing the headphones says, Mark.
Wow.
You know, and it's just like, it's like, okay, now we're having a conversation with something. So, you know, we've kind of touched on people being sensitive a little bit. You know, I like our group relies a lot. Well, everything we do relies on our evidence that we capture. You know, as far as being sensitive, Carla is probably the most sensitive in our group. And I, like I said, I am a little bit, and Carla and I play well off of each other as far as we can sometimes just look at each other and go, you see that? Yeah. And you know, about the best way that we could use that, as soon as Carla and I start picking up on that, is we'll, you know, start taking devices. You see that on the other end of that hallway? And we'll go take a voice recorder down there. We'll take a camera, start snapping pictures.
and stuff like that, because nobody believes you when you said, oh, this happened to me. But if you can go, this happened and here it is, listen to this or look at this picture and tell me what you think. On our Facebook page, we had uploaded a picture, one of the very first pictures I think Mike ever took. And it actually won him first place. Oh, yeah, I'm sorry. They're pointing at me, telling me I'm wrong. It was a picture Debra took.
She took the camera away from him.
Yeah, Debra took the camera away from Mike and told him that he was a man and didn't know how to use anything. And... but there was a picture. It was three or four pictures in a row, and the first couple were clear, and then the third one was a little hazy, and then the fourth one is what you can find on Star Paranormal's Facebook page. The fourth one has so much stuff going on in it, it's hard to just focus on one thing. And at the exact same time, Mike was talking about one of our devices called the Ovulus that has a word database. You talk about. Thankfully, I wasn't there because I don't know how I would have reacted. I had to work that night. But at the same time the picture was taken, the ovulus had went off, and it had said that D word that us paranormal investigators hate to use, and it was demon. And to describe what was going on in that picture, just words can't do it justice. I mean, I guess that's a little plug for Star Paranormal Facebook page.
Go for it. You plug the heck out of it.
Sitting down right on the grave talking.
But there's in the center of the picture is supposed to be just, you know, I talked about paranormal junkies, and we were part of that team before. And the leader of the paranormal junkies is actually, and you can hardly see her in the picture, but she's standing in the middle of it, and she's standing with her feet together and her hands kind of cupped in front of her, and it's the stuff that's going on around her and throughout the entire picture that makes that picture interesting. Like I said, Mike entered that into a contest in Florida, and he won first place for it.
It was a Halloween contest.
Yeah, it was a Halloween photo contest.
Wow. I'm going to have to go in there and check it out.
Paranormal photography.
Yeah, Nancy.
Right.
She looked at it and couldn't explain it.
Right. We were at a paranormal conference a couple of years ago, and there was a lady. She's a full-time photographer, and she's a part of the paranormal team. And for the life of me, I know her name is Nancy, but I can't think of her last name, and I can't, at 10 o'clock at night, can't think of her team name. But she told us, you know, if y'all have pictures, come show it to me, and I can tell you if it's
lighting
issue or something just came in front of the camera, or
and we said, here, look at this.
Yeah, Mike said, look at this picture, tell me what you think, and she was like, oh my god. But I prefer to do things more off of our evidence than I do off of any kind of personal experience. You know, if we go to a private residence, and we had that, Mike said he sent that EVP to you about Afghanistan, and
can I play it real quick?
Yeah, you can play that one.
All right, here we go.
Touch one of us.
The right one, lady.
Touch one of us.
I don't know if that was the right one or not.
That's the fourth. Okay, they're telling me that's not the right one.
Okay.
I don't remember.
That was the Terror Nights.
That one was done at Terror Nights. This one was done at a private residence. A guy that Mike and I both know, he's still around.
Yeah.
He's
not him on the audio.
Do what?
I said it's not him on the audio.
It's not him on the audio. But he's telling us about all this stuff going on. He wants to do an investigation. Well, the thing is, he's a veteran of the Iraqi war, and he was in Afghanistan. He did a couple of tours.
You know, and the stuff that he told us is, I mean, that stuff that you wouldn't think somebody would share with us, but he told us, he said, I want y'all to figure out what was going on, so I'm just going to be straight up honest with you. He talked about having PTSD and stuff like that. And then as we're going through with this EVP, it's a bit choppy. We had to kind of put it together, but it's a spirit telling. We believe it was a spirit telling him. It literally said, do not go back to Afghanistan.
Wow.
Portal. I think that came through the portal.
Wow.
Right. That one was done on our device that Eddie built called the portal.
Huh. Well, hey, we're down to 2 minutes.
I'll be listening.
What
do you think?
Yeah. Ma'am.
We're down to 2 minutes. And, what did she say?
What did you say, Debra?
I was just going to say there's been several instances, I guess maybe with Eddie and I being the skeptics of the group, and I think as far as people sensing something, I'm probably the least one that's ever going to pick up on a sense or feel something or see something. So pretty much if Eddie or I say, did y'all hear that or did y'all see that, everybody usually goes to look at what we're thinking we're seeing or trying to hear what we heard.
Exactly.
Has
anyone ever been touched or scratched or anything like that? Hair pulled.
Yes.
Yeah, I'll take that. This was actually the day that I learned that these things can't hurt you. We were leading a tour at a haunted location. It was in the middle of the woods. It was an old Civil War prison camp. Long story short, towards the end of it, one of the very sensitive people there said, something's coming, we got to get everybody out. And these people aren't,
oh, wow.
I mean, they're just tourists. They don't know anything about paranormal, so we're trying to kind of push them all, you know, get them out of that area.
Well, I'm getting a countdown. I hope this show doesn't go off the air before you finish your story, but go ahead. Keep going.
Anyways, I got to arguing with the guy. He's wanting to go last. I said, no, if anything's going to happen, I want it to happen to me. And sure enough, it did. It felt like something jumped on my back, weighed me down. I got to the point I couldn't walk. A couple people had to come back for me. They managed to get whatever it was away from me. And, I mean, I was affected. I'm in law enforcement. I'm not a small guy. And when I got done with that, they had to get me out of there. I broke down into tears. I have never had anything like that happen to me before. I almost quit over that.
Wow. Well, I thank you guys for coming on. It's been a wonderful show. Y'all were fantastic. Got to have you back for a part two.
Definitely.
And everyone, next week, we've got Luke Grove coming back. Hurrah. And, I think it's going to give us a little bit. We're off the air, but we're still streaming. But
I
wanted to...
And then it cuts us off.
About 5 minutes, yeah. Well, I'm very excited because I had a very similar experience to what Jeremy had. Oh, my goodness.
Mm-hmm.
It was very, very similar. Wow. I would like to get a hold of somebody and tell them about it, but I don't know if I really have the time right now. But, wow. Okay.
It was terrifying. So,
and where was this at?
This was in Tyler.
Camp Ford.
It's called Camp Ford. It's an old Civil War prison camp. As a matter of fact, during the Civil War, it was the largest Civil War prison camp, west of the Mississippi. You just don't hear about it because they had fresh water running through the middle of the camp, so you didn't have all the sickness and you didn't have all the sickness and death due to sickness and illness that you did at the other Civil War camps, and it was mainly because of the fresh water that rolled through there. But
But I have since been back, and I have since faced down that same thing. But you know, I came back stronger with more knowledge. So.
Yeah. Oh my goodness! I know just what you're talking about. Yeah. Well, we're just going to have you guys back. You know, our show isn't all about Bigfoot. We have paranormal and UFOs, Chupacabra, and Loch Ness Monster, and just anything that mysterious is on. So we will have y'all back for sure. We just want to thank you for giving up probably one of the best nights to do paranormal research is on Halloween night, which is probably what Jeff is doing, that turkey. And anyway, he should have done a live in the field, by goodness. He should have just got on the phone and said, I'm live in the field. But anyway.
We'll have to try to put y'all along on an investigation one night.
I would love that. Absolutely love that. I would come. I promise. I would come. I will send y'all my phone number. You let me know. I used to do it a long time ago, many, many years ago, until I discovered Bigfoot, which was a whole new passion. So, yes, I do. I would love to come with you guys. I'd be fascinated to watch how you do it. You know, a paranormal field has come along so much since I was doing it back then. So, okay, well, we're going to tell everyone good night, everyone, and we are going to go ahead and call it a night. And
thank y'all so much.
Okay, thank you for coming on. Y'all were awesome.
Bye, guys.
Thank you.
Awesome. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
All right, good night, everyone.